David is. And so yeah. Because God had to finish, he is finishing their progression. Solomon's temple was the perfect temple. Perfectly built, elaborate. It was a type of the church. It was a type of the people of God. No chisels was heard. No hammers was heard building it. It was built in the wilderness and erected in Jerusalem. Okay? But you didn't hear no tools in Jerusalem making it. In essence, is that we're supposed to be the temple of God, which is made without hands. You see what I'm saying? So what Solomon's temple represented was the perfect church. Okay? It didn't have, it had 10 labors of water, which if you go back to Tabernacle of Moses, it only had one. But it's showing the perfection and the completion of that temple. Even though it had 10 labors, it had 10 showbread tables, it had completion of stuff, but it only had one altar. Okay. It's order. That's why you had 10 commandments. It was order. It was perfection. Tens is like a perfected number. That's why when it used that he owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. Well, we know if you count, it's more than 1,000 hills, but it's a completion of hills. It's not a definite number. In the book of Revelation, 1,000 years, it's not 1,000. It is a completion of something. All right? Okay. Man, God is good today, yesterday, and he will be good forever. Praise God. I'm always excited about talking about the Word of God. I think there's nothing more exciting to me than talking about it, teaching about it, knowing about it. You know, I don't just want to know a little something about God. I want to be able to embrace everything God says I can have and know. We've been talking about the Tabernacle of David and how in Acts chapter 15 where God, and Acts chapter 15 is your first general conference. It's your first convocation. It's your first big assembly where you're getting all these apostolics together. They got all kinds of problems going on in the churches and they're trying to rectify and come up with something because now they got a problem in the church. And Book of Acts is they come in, the apostles come from different places. Some of them got Gentiles in the church. Well, they never had Gentiles in the church. So now what do we do with the Gentile? Because they're not Jews. And so part of Acts chapter 15 is about that. It's about trying to establish some type of rule or guidelines to, again, conform the church. Because you need to realize one thing. One, you know, the Jews knew how to be Jewish. They didn't know how to be Christian, but they knew how to be Jews. All right? And so for them, it was just eye-opening experience as it was a Gentile. But with their knowledge, with a little bit of knowledge of God, they kind of had a little bit of insight about God. So there are certain things, you know, that they weren't going to probably indulge in or even consider. You know, they weren't going to consider a pork chop sandwich. Well, you got Gentiles coming in. Well, you know, they eat pig feet. What are you going to do with that? I'm trying to make it simple so you understand what I'm saying. Is that you had two different kinds of people coming together. You had one, you know, they eating kosher food. You know, Gentiles, man, they just eating chickens and everything. They don't care what it is, possum coons. They eating it all. And so now they got to come to church and you got to not only see their church is not just about everybody going to their separate places. Church in the beginning, people really desired unity. They really wanted unity. And so you invite somebody over your house. I'm a Gentile. I invite Sister Cecil, she's a Jew, to my house. Well, I ain't used to cooking for them. So I got chitlins. She's a Jew. She don't eat pork. But really, for the sake of unity, first of all, I didn't know. You know the Bible say, eat whatever's set before you. And that's no Christian conscience thing. And unless you knew that which is being offered you was offered to an idol. Even though the idol is nothing, but because of the conscience of the person, I wouldn't eat. All right? If I went in there to the Chinese restaurant and they told me they just sacrificed that duck, as much as I love duck, I wouldn't eat it. But if they just put it in the wok and stir fried, I'm on it. So what you got in the book of Acts, your first conference coming together, because now we got to figure out how much Jew can we put into Gentiles? How Jewish can we make them? Because we're Jewish. So when it comes to the conference in Acts chapter 15, that's when James began to get, he said, I feel it's good to, the Holy Ghost says it's good to us and the Holy Ghost that we put nothing on these people other than. And he went on, you know, no fornication, don't eat blood, things strangle of themselves. In other words, you can't go get the roadkill anymore. Just tell them leave the roadkills alone. Don't eat blood, because even today, there's a lot of people eat blood sausage. I mean, you go down Louisiana, you know, it's tempting for me. I kind of think it's good, probably, but I've never had it. What do you mean? Do you realize that when you eat the flesh of an animal, especially beef and any other animal, you're eating blood? Did you know that? It ain't number blood. And do you know what this is out here? It's blood. This is blood. This is coagulated blood. Hello? This is coagulated blood. That's all it is. You ever notice when you cut yourself, you bleed and scabs? It's coagulated blood. So basically, the blood in you is nothing more than liquid flesh. Yeah, that's all. The life of the flesh is where? It's in the blood. So basically what you don't understand is that this out here is congealed, consolidated, but it flows like liquid through you. Well, Lord. I shouldn't be telling y'all all this stuff. I shouldn't be telling y'all this. But anyway, where was that? But they were trying to make them more Jewish. And so James and the Holy Ghost, remember, the Holy Ghost is using it. He said, and we ain't going to put no more on them than this. Then somebody came back and tried to make us more Jewish again. I let it ride. But he said, I'm going to raise back up the ruins of David's tabernacle. Now, in order for us to know, like I said before, you need to know what was it about David's tabernacle that God would even want. He had the cheapest one God ever stayed in. It wasn't nothing but a tent. God has stayed in more elaborate places. Even Moses' tabernacle was better looking than David's. And Solomon definitely was, but he never said, I want Solomon's temple. Solomon's temple was one of the most wealthiest, was one of the eighth wonders of the world. It had overlaid gold and all kind of stuff. It had more riches in that temple than you could even dream of. Matter of fact, Bill Gates would have a hard time building that one right now. Has so much gold in it. But God never once said, you know what I want to do? I want to build Solomon's temple again. Unlike the Knights of Templar and all these other Zionist people that are saying God's going to build another temple. God ain't never was pleased in a building. He's always been pleased with people. When you realize that, if God would have been pleased with a church building, he would have gave Adam a building to start. But instead, he was so pleased with Adam, he let him walk before him naked. Yep. He said, because I don't want nothing standing between me and you. You ain't got to hide from me. That's what religion done. Religion clothed us so we can hide. The first thing Adam done when he sinned, guess what he done? Let me say this before we go any further. I don't want y'all to misunderstand me. Don't try to tell me you're close to God now and come here naked. That's not what I'm talking about. I just want to make sure y'all hearing me right, because sometimes people take myself out of context. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying in the beginning, if you want to know what God wants, from the beginning we see man was naked before God. Man didn't know he was naked until he started getting sinful. He was always sinful. Well, let me put it this way. He was always earthy. Anything came from the earth has to go back to the earth. So he's already in vanity. Matter of fact, the Bible even talks about being created in vanity. Means there's a part of him that's not there that he needs. That's why God put the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life in the garden. So man could make that decision. Do you want to live or die? What did man choose? He chose to die. And the Bible said he wasn't deceived to die. He chose to die. Right? Eve got deceived, but Adam willfully said, I'm going to die. And the minute they begin to see death, it calls for them to hide. Because it's hard to stand in front of life when your mind is on dying. And so they put some stuff on to hide or try to hide where they had fallen to. That's the reason why he even tells you in the scripture, by this shall all men know that you are my disciple. We've tried to dress it up, hide behind it, but you can't. Our thoughts, our minds are open always unto God. There's never a time. There's not one thought ever hid from him. There's not one intent, motive, anything else I got. None of those things ever hid. I'm just as naked as a jaybird before God. He knows my getting up. He knows my sitting down, my uprising, laying down. He knows all of that. And so I don't even have to come to God and try to put on. I don't even come to God and try to tell him anything. Now, he already knows everything. I just come to thank him. I just come to give him thanks for knowing me and loving me in spite of me. That's what I give him thanks for. It's because there's nothing I can tell God he don't already know about me or you. Not one thing. And so that's why I can boldly come before his throne, because I already know I can't hide nothing from him. I ain't going to get help because I done hear something from it. No. Ain't going to happen. But most, even the tabernacle, the temple, allowed people to hide in it. But the tent is wide open. Everybody. You see, Moses didn't have everybody worshiping God. In Moses' tabernacle, everybody wasn't praising God. In Moses' tabernacle, everybody couldn't even see God. But David's temple, David's tabernacle, everybody, it didn't matter who you were. Matter of fact, when you look at the genealogy of the people that were around that tabernacle of David, you're going to find he had more Gentiles in his tabernacle of praise and worship than anybody had. In Moses' tabernacle, you had to be somebody to get that. Had it. One of my friends today, I was talking to him on the phone this morning, he said someone asked him to teach, or he had somebody came and they wanted to teach, and they told him what position they held, what title they held. He said, for me to do that, I'd be coming down. Let me tell you something. I could preach, teach. I even clean the bathroom if I have to. If my position doesn't allow me to minister, I don't care how old you are, then I don't have one. Because my ministry is not my ministry. My ministry is his ministry. And I need to be willing to allow his ministry to minister to anybody that he will minister through me to. I don't think. Now I know, but Moses promotes this. His ministry promotes that kind of stuff. Jealousy. It promotes that. I got to be greater. I got to move up. Move up where? Why can you move up in God? Ain't no moving up. You can't move up. You can't get no higher than that. You can't get no higher than him. You ain't going to move up. Forget the moving up and begin to focus on the manifestation of where you are in God. If I'm that high in God, then let me manifest some high things out here. But my title doesn't make me anything. It's what God says that I am that you can't mess with. I don't care what you call me. You can call me whatever. But I got to know who he says I am. And then I'm going to operate in who he says I am. Again, I tell anybody, anointing is not for your entertainment. It's for his purpose. Don't let me ever misuse what he gives me by trying to entertain myself with it. Oh, yeah, I know. I used to love to hear myself preach. I know I say things, it's funny, but it ain't funny, but it's the truth. You can't get stuck on yourself. Oh, yeah. Yeah, in this thing here, you can get, there's a whole lot of things God will bring you through. Man, he wakes you up every now and then to let you see yourself, and then you see where you think you was and where you're not. I appreciate God. I love him. I love what he does. I love how he does it because he always do it right. Always do it right. But here is David's tabernacle. There's people 24/7 because God, you know, what they were doing was a lifestyle. What God was trying to show, he wanted a lifestyle of people. He wanted so that every day, every moment, every minute, there's somewhere in this world, somebody is praising him. He wanted that to be the norm instead of waiting once a year to have a shout. Yeah, it was once a year for them. It's when the high priest go in and he came back out, they had to shout. And so they had got to wait a whole year to get the shout on again. How many people wait? I even heard one guy told me this morning. He said, well, man, you know, boy, they can't wait to get this youth conference. Well, I love youth. I love conferences, period. They're okay. But I don't wait once a year so I can get a shout. I'm not waiting for some conference to come along that I might get free. I'm not trying to figure out if this is going to be a conference or somebody going to have some miracle working conference. Let me tell you something. What God showed us in the tabernacle of David is that God is real every day. Every day. He needs somebody to show his reality by getting up every day. I love prayer meetings, and I said it Thursday night. I think I'm going to say it again. I love prayer meetings, but if that's the only time we pray, then we ain't praying. I ain't about just trying to make one day special. I want to make every day I live. Every day I live is a special day. Woo, praise God. And the older I get, it gets more special. Man, you wake up every morning, and after a while, you get about over 50, all of a sudden you realize you're reading the obituary, people dying, ain't even old as you. That's why I quit reading them. Man, that's what's shaking me up, man, because, you know, you kids watching people die, and you wonder when it's going to come get you. Well, I'm just being serious. I can't be thinking about dying if I'm going to be living. So if I'm reading obituary, I'm thinking more about dead people than I am about living people. I am not thinking about the dead. I am thinking about life. I'm thinking about living life every day. I want to get up every day and let God take control of the whole day, not just a portion, but my whole day. I want that to be consumed with God. Does every day turn out good? Well, it depends on who's judging. If he let me judge it, I'll tell him no. But then I have to check myself and realize one thing. You got up. You're breathing. And not only are you breathing, man, but you're semi-healthy today. I will think that's a good day. Praise God. But you know, sometimes we're so bent on dying that we can't live, because dead people are always thinking about what they don't have and what they got to get. And you can't enjoy this moment because you're either in the future or in the past. I enjoy this moment. Everything I need at this present moment, I got it. I got it. Praise God. Any question about Tabernacle of David that you may have, that you may want to ask? Because I do want to move on just a little bit. I want to kind of get us focused, I think. And I say this not to make you feel bad or look bad. What I'm teaching you, I didn't know either when I came in. But I've never been a person just sit back and drink Kool-Aid because you made it. I will eventually check it out for myself. And if I check it out for myself and I see things is not kind of lining up a little bit, I'm still not going to go crazy, but I'm going to keep searching. Because I know there is a truth. There is a real Jesus. Not a fabricated one or a Jesus fantasy, but there is a real God. That's who I want to know. So I'm not just teaching us this because I'm trying to say that we don't know anything, but I didn't know this either. I wouldn't have never known it except that God would help me see it. But there are certain things in the Bible that he lays it out for you. And sometimes we don't see the significance of why he painted that picture. See, because the whole canvas of God is painted in the old covenant. He paints a canvas of a lot of things in that old covenant that we're not aware of, then we're really missing our own progress, missing our own elevation in God. It's because there are certain protocols, there are certain processes of God I think is important when it comes to God. I don't think he had put anything together. And what really gets me going is the fact when I see him doing the same thing, maybe in a different way, but the same results. No matter how you look at it, it's always the same story told a different way. Whether it be Abraham offering his son on Mount Moriah. Yeah. He offered him on Mount Moriah. It became Mount Moriah. He offered him on that. That's just telling me another story. God has a man here that loves him so much. Name Abraham. He loves God so much that he's willing to kill his son for God. But we know that in God's economy, God does not believe in that infanticide. He doesn't believe in people sacrifice. Matter of fact, it's an abomination to offer a sacrifice of a human being. But yet God has a man set up and look like God's going to violate his law by accepting a dead man as a sacrifice. But instead, he's checking a man's heart. It's easy for me to tell you how much I love God. Sometimes it's a lot harder for me to show. You want me to say that again? See, it's easy for me to tell you how much I love God. Well, sometimes it's hard for me to show. And a lot of times when you say, I love God more than anything, then anything shows up. And all of a sudden you realize, well, now, I love us. You know, I love us. I love the people of God. You cannot get no better than this. I'm telling you, it is awesome. It is so awesome to be a child of God. It's awesome to be in the company of the people of God. But I've met people in my life who tell me how much they love God until they love God more than anything, and then anything shows up. And you know what their problem is then is this. Well, God wouldn't ask me to do that. Now, first of all, before you ever say anything like that, read the Bible. God has showed himself sometimes in places being calloused. Prophet's wife died. He wouldn't even let him cry. Uh-oh. God does some things in his Bible sometimes when you say, I know God wouldn't put me through that because he loved me. But wait a minute. He bragged on a dude one time he loved. He bragged on him. See, I want him to brag on me, but. Sometimes our bragging is more, oh, we bragging about ourselves. God ain't bragging yet. Because when he starts bragging, you start crying. Yeah, he started bragging on you. Now you all know, oh man, the devil bad. The devil, man, I don't know. Oh. But when you're bragging on yourself, see, you're talking about how you whooping the devil. But when God brags on you, it looks like the devil's whooping you. Because God is getting some scriptures together you've been quoting. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Ain't that something? But now you're crying like a baby. Is that a weapon formed? What are you crying about then? If you've been quoting that, then you ought to be rejoicing when the weapon is formed. He didn't say if the weapon, he said no weapon formed against me shall prosper. That's exactly what God meant. He did not say it wouldn't be formed. He didn't even say it wouldn't attack. But it will never prosper. But now, to even think sometimes in our fantasies of Christianity and not understanding, God is taking the covers off. He don't want the veil on. He wants you to be able to walk with confidence before him every day of your life and not be able to be afraid to pray and ask God for whatever you have need of because you don't feel like you deserve it. If I got his blood, I deserve his blessing. Uh-oh. Oh, Jesus. Lord have mercy. Anyway, as I was saying, I'm trying to get out of this here. Trying to move on to something else. Any question? Okay. Let's move a little bit further. I say some more things this morning when I was sitting here just kind of looking over some things. You know, it's funny how God, all the time, I'm not talking about sometimes, just like the most simplest things in the Word of God, he can just feed you with it. The most simplest thing. And sometimes all it takes is just you waking up with a desire just to know something. And that's all. Because he really do want to feed you every day. Every day. No, he may not give you a smorgasbord or buffet. He may give you a snack and go. But snack and go. Because I believe every day God wants to give me something. And so you know what I wake up every day looking for? I wake up every day expecting God to give me something. Let me get a little bit more insight. No, not to give me more insight so I can show you how smart I am, but give me more insight so I can change.
Yes, that's right.
See, I can't make a change without the right information. Amen. And if you ain't got the right information, there is no confirmation. And there will be no transformation without the right information. So I want the right information. What is it, God? See, I already know is that no matter how good I am today, I know there's better. I'm never satisfied with just being here. But I know that if I have a God that has so much abundance, I mean, he's abundant in everything. God is not stingy. He's not Republican. Nor Democrat. But he's not conservative. He's liberal. That makes people mad. Man, I preached that at a conference. Man, I had a guy so mad he didn't even want to ride home with me to the airport. I said, God is a liberal. But see, he thought I was attacking his religion. Because his religion and our religion was very conservative. And so I looked up the dictionary of what conservative was. Basically, a conservative person is a stingy person. Mm-mm. That means there's a lot of things we ain't going to give you being a conservative. So religion made us very conservative because we even got what we call a conservative look. And if I seen you, I know I can't get too much from you because you're stingy. You're going to be stingy with your love. You're going to be stingy with your forgiveness. You're going to be stingy with mercy. All the things that God has freely given you, you're going to be stingy with it. And then what happened with conservative mindset is that they want everybody to pay for what they got for free. I got it. Anyway, what was I on just then? I'm trying to move on. Any questions? You know, I just love the Word of God. I probably would never finish a lesson if I tried. But but we want to look at, see, where do I want to start here? I've been in his tabernacle for so long, I don't. Well, I got to draw the picture again. That's one thing. Got to get that visual aid one more time. I know you get tired of this picture. Yep. But anyway, that's the picture. That is, according to Hebrew, it's made according to plan. It's made of things in heaven. If I want to know the order of things, I need to understand this part. If it's the plan or the blueprint for things in heaven, I need to understand this. Because I realize that all these things were just a shadow. Not substance, but shadows. And so I realize it is a shadow. So I can look at the shadow. It starts forming what the shadow is coming from. Because see, when the sun rose in the east, the cross was laying west, and it would have been the cross, the shadow of the cross that this was built in. All right? But so I need to understand that process. I need to understand not just that it was a tabernacle, but what has that to do with me? When I go back and read the Word of God, I need to know how does that apply to me? How is that relevant to me? Because there are things in there that's really maybe not relevant, but it is, but you couldn't connect it. You know, some things I don't think is, such as, you know, who got begat. It's relevant, but it's not really relevant to me. See, Kunta Kinta. No, I didn't watch it. But what I'm saying is this, is that there's some things in here that, I mean, it's not going to be relevant to me. I mean, I can look at Noah's Ark, go through the measurements and all that kind of stuff. I mean, that's great, but it really has no real relevance to me, okay? Because I know there ain't going to be that much water coming again. So I'm not really going to argue over how tall it was, how many train loads it would hold. I'm not going to get in none of that. If you think it was just big as a Volkswagen, that's fine. You know, I got people arguing about all kind of stuff. I ain't going to argue about that because if it wasn't, does it make a difference? None. Man, they're going to find that ark. If they find the ark, then what? I already know what it's made of. Wood. So it ain't no holy wood. So there are things that God wants to make relevant to you. You know, you don't just want to be able to quote scriptures and not know what the scriptures really mean, because you can't know what it means just by quoting it, but you got to experience it. So he's not just giving you the word so you can say, well, I got this word, I got the word, I got the word. No, he wants the word to get you. I got to have that word a part of me. It's got to be the engrafted. Everybody said engrafted. It's engrafted. Engrafted, you know what that is, right? Everybody know what engrafted is, don't you? You know what skin graft is, right? Yeah, you know, you get skin graft, you know, they put it on you, it takes a while for it to connect. But when it connects, it looks like a part of you. That should be the way the word of God is in our life. Is that every time that engrafted word gets in us, it should become a part of us. That's the reason why a lot of times, and we do, we get a conversation, we can tell what got engrafted versus what didn't. Yeah. No, Lachelle helped me a lot. She's helped me a whole lot in that she'll check me when I say something wrong. She checked me when I'm thinking something wrong. No, for real. But it's good. I like that because, you know, a lot of times I've gotten upset stuff that it sounded okay, and you would say amen to it, but really, the Holy Ghost can't say amen to it. The Holy Ghost is not amen in everything you amen. I get them say, I'm broke. Amen. No, don't amen that. I don't know how many times I would get up, and you know, we so small, if we got two pennies, we broke. And then we start naming ourselves stuff that we're not. We start telling heaven and all of the world, the spirit world, I am broke. And guess what? They believe you.
Yes, they do.
That's just like everything else. I'm sick. Guess what? You're going to be sick then. See, I'm telling you, the more you talk about being sick, you're going to be sick. Well, why can't we talk about being healed? I told you, I went out here the other day, had to get some work done, trying to get it done. Anyway, the woman said she wanted to take my blood pressure. She takes my blood pressure, it's almost like 200 over 130 something. She asked me to sit down. I was feeling kind of bad. I was feeling kind of rough. I knew something was wrong with me. But I wasn't in there for that. I was in there for another reason. But anyway, she said, sir, are you on high blood pressure medicine? I said, no, ma'am. She said, well, you probably ought to get some. I said, I hear you, but no. Uh-oh, here we go. Now, don't get me wrong. I done told y'all over and over again, I got to walk by this faith I have. I'm not here to try to control yours, but I am very much concerned about my faith in God. And I went home. I lay still for a minute. And I went down the line in my life and got to thinking, now what is causing all this? What is happening and causing all this? I got to figure out what's causing all this, see? Because that's not normal. Now, you know, they say all kind of stuff, but I don't repeat what they say because I believe what Jesus said. You understand? So I have a choice here. I can go on and say, well, you know, man, I got high blood pressure. I got high blood pressure. You know, it may jump up every now and then, but you see, I ain't got it. I still believe I'm still healed, and I'm going to be here until Jesus say I can't stay. I am not, you are not going to get me dollar 911, run to the hospital so I can get me a pill. I'm sorry. You know what I thank God for? I thank God that he has given me an assurance in my heart today that I don't have to fear anything. I don't have to fear that. Well, Brother Wilson, you better be careful. You all be careful. I am. I'm very careful. I'm so careful I believe in Jesus. He has become my gold card. I don't leave home without him. So I'm not, like I said before, I'm not trying to tell you how to do your thing, because one thing about this is that you need to know him so you know what's yours. And if you don't know him, you're not going to know what's yours. You got to get in him to know what's yours. And if I find out in him that this is mine, then why am I sitting here still playing around with these other people and they telling me all kind of crazy stuff when he already told me something? I don't get a second opinion on God. There's some things I know. And those things I don't have to compromise on because I know. Simple. And the more I know, the more I'm going to speak. As I have believed, so will I speak. I don't want something coming out my mouth that I ain't believed in my heart. But once I believe it in my heart, I want it to come out of my mouth. Why? Because I believe that. The life, your life is flowing from your heart right now. Either you're saying the right stuff or you're killing your own self. Some of us all just go home, take the gun and shoot ourselves in it. No. But basically, that's what you're doing. You're committing spiritual suicide with your mouth. Yeah, you're taking strychnine on your own. Devil don't have to do nothing. You're already doing it to yourself. And blaming it on the devil. The devil don't have no power over you unless you give it to him. He can't make nothing happen in your life unless you give him the door to make it happen. He can't make you do anything. If God can't make you do it, I know the devil can't. Huh? So quit blaming the devil about that. He ain't making you sick. Your mouth is making you sick. Yeah, you get the right stuff in your lips, get the right stuff in your heart. I promise you, he said he will cure all. Everybody said all. Heal all our diseases. Did some new ones come up or something? All of a sudden, God got weak. He didn't know there's going to be some new diseases. But I think all diseases start from one place. And if he can, see, you know part of our problem is? If you don't believe God can forgive sin, you don't believe he can heal diseases. Well, think about it. You ain't gonna believe it. People make it look like Jesus went to Calvary a couple of times. How many times did he go? One time. With the same stroke, he took care of your sin, your sickness, your death. He took everything, one swipe. But all of a sudden now, we don't mind putting up with sickness, but we won't put up with sin. And the biggest sin we put up with is called unbelief in the first place. And that's why many times we can't get healed. God heal me of my unbelief. Now if you want to pray a prayer, pray that prayer. God heal me of my unbelief, because my unbelief is the only thing stopping God from operating in my life. You cannot believe in him and not receive what he said you'd get. Well, God, I don't think God wants me to have it. What? He done all that and don't want you to have it? Huh? What? Why wouldn't he want you to have it? What's wrong with you? Huh? Something different about you? He don't want you to have it? I thought when he died for everybody, he just painted the brush. He wanted to give it to everybody. I didn't know he was holding out on some people. I didn't know he was waiting for somebody to get better so they can get it. I didn't know that. But see, our whole concept about God has been so messed up. Is that if we can never get past that veil, we can never get past the veil of our mind, get this veil off our minds and realize the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ is that he's not coming to do something else. He's already done everything you're going to need in this earth and in the world to come. Everything you're going to need now and later is here. You know, they got some candy called now or later. Well, he liked that candy, now or later. He's got it all under control. So we want to make sure, and again, it's that there's just so many things that we can teach about when we come talk about these things. And I'm not trying to attack you or anything about you, but I am trying to express to you the truth of the Word of God. All I ask you to do, don't just take my word for it. Search it out. I don't believe God loves me anymore. He loves you. I really don't. I tell y'all that sometimes just to make myself feel good, but I know he loves you just as much. So what we're going to do, though, is look at the tabernacle from a perspective that we should be seeing it from instead of the way we have looked at it. Because we have spent so many years trying to bring people and get people to heaven. Most of our preaching, it's not about you enjoying heavenly things now. Most of our preaching is putting heaven on a delay plan. Work hard enough so you can go there. But really, that is not the Bible. That's not what it tells you. Matter of fact, when Jesus, in the book of Ephesians, what it says, he has made us. Made. Everybody said made. Say that was yesterday. See, made means yesterday. So it was yesterday he made us to do what? Sit together where? So I wonder what happened if you don't. You're probably going to live in some hellish places then. Life going to be filled with a whole bunch of hellish stuff. Because you'll never be able to see what heaven has to offer as long as you're down here on earth hanging out. Unless you transcend and get into the presence of God, you'll never know his pleasure nor his joy. I got to be in his presence to receive what God is trying to offer me. So in other words, it's that we tell everybody, we preach, you know, if you live right, you'll go to heaven. No, if you believe, you'll get in heaven right now. You'll be in heavenly place. What, you know, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost we talk about, that is a heavenly spirit. All right? That's why the Bible say, eyes have not seen, no ears heard, no has it entered the heart of man, the things God has prepared them to love him. And then they stop. Man, people used to shout on that. I get in church, whoo, got me all thinking about my mansion in the sky, my catfish pond in the back with my little, I got my little walk way out to the lake with sliding doors on the back. I used to be sitting back just dreaming, boy, I want my mansion to be like this. Not knowing. The next verse tells me something. It said, eyes haven't seen, ears heard, nor has any heart of man things God has prepared them to love him. And then he turns around and messes up everything. But it has been revealed unto us. How? And you ain't going to get the Holy Ghost in you and show you a catfish pond in your backyard. Hello? It ain't going to happen. That was all my fantasy about going to heaven. But I realize I'm not dying to go. Hey, I'm living to be there every day. Not just sometime. No, I know sometimes we got this thing. We got all kinds of things we talk about God. Man, we had a high time in God. You didn't have no high time. You just felt better. Because if you ain't waking up every day in a high time, you probably didn't have a high time when you went to church. Come on. Huh? You ain't created nothing where you ain't been. Hello? And so you talk about, well, I want to give God the highest praise. That ain't the highest praise unless you've been in the highest place. If you ain't been in a high place, you ain't giving God no high praise. But if you've been in a high place, and he made us to sit together with him in these places. As a matter of fact, he's given us these spiritual blessings in where? And we're down here trying to get what? Not no spiritual blessings. Our spiritual blessings, these blessings he's given us, all spiritual blessings. All spiritual blessings. All spiritual blessings in heavenly places. But if I'm not going living in heavenly places, I'm not enjoying the spiritual blessings. And I think when you get one-sided and you're not quite tilted right, it can cause a lot of frustration. I'm going to take my dominion on earth and take my dominion in heavenly places. I want to experience the blessings of earth while I also have access to the blessings, all spiritual blessings in heaven. I'd rather pursue the spiritual blessings first so it'll keep me balanced with earth things. Well, anyway, I don't even know where I'm going now. I don't even know how I got there. Forgive me. Okay, I got a few more minutes. Any questions, though? Any questions? None? Well, let's try this spiritual progression. You know, I showed you this before. No matter how you teach, the whole Bible sits on top of this here. No matter what I can take and teach Genesis and everything else, Book of Revelation, everything sits on top of this right here. Because it is the pattern. And everything will fit. And if it don't fit, it means it should not be there. If you can't make it fit on this here, it's because it's not supposed to be, because this is the plan of God. And so that's how I gauge and judge doctrine, is how does it fit the blueprint. If it doesn't fit the blueprint, then I don't have to worry about it. God doesn't add any new stuff, even though we might add some new stuff down the road. And we add a whole bunch of stuff, you know, because at the rate we have done since the inception of the gospel and the different things that different people had to come to be saved in the gospel, man, I don't know who would be saved if God had to use their measurement to save anybody. You know, what about the people that didn't have their shoes closed in and had open-toed shoes? Did they make it? Huh? What about the people that didn't quite do it like we did? Did they make it? Because, see, one of the things I found out is that we have declared a lot of things with our mouth that God didn't declare. My job is not to figure out how many people are going to be lost. My job is to minister reconciliation to this world. And what God does with that, that's his business. Salvation is God's business. He ain't going to call me to make you be saved or lost. I can't put you in, nor can I take you out. Who has ascended up to bring him down? And who went down to bring him up? None of us. And so I don't have a right. I can't. Oh, Brother Wilson, there you go. You compromise. You believe anybody, everybody say. That ain't my problem. I'm a witness, not a judge. I didn't come to judge the world. I came to witness to the world. You know where he called you to be? But you can't be a witness so you know what a witness is. A witness is when you are dead and he's alive. Well, Lord, boy, y'all gonna mess me up this morning. Y'all gonna mess me up. But anyway, God is so good to me. In the true progression, in this true spiritual progression, of course, with God, he didn't start where man started. He started where man was trying to go. He came down. Man always trying to work his way up. That's why they built the Tower of Babel. They was trying to get up. But he already knew nothing you're going to build going to get you up that high. You're going to run out of air. And you're going to run out of time. So what he done is that, you know what? He said, I'm not going to let them keep struggling like this. That's why Jesus came and said, come unto me, all ye that labor. And I have it laden. I know you've been carrying a load. You've been working yourself to death and you ain't got there yet. And you ain't going to make it there like that. He said, but if you just come unto me right now, all you that labor and heavy laden, I will give you. Now you would think after all those years of toiling, working, knowing that you ain't getting it right, but you're just doing it. Knowing that you ain't changed, but you're just doing it. And here comes Jesus and says, you know what I'm going to do? You can't beat this. If you've been working hard, you've been laboring, toiling, killing yourself, walking the floor, talking about how, you know, you're interceding and pressed out. And he said, come unto me. Come. He said, because I want to give you something. Do you know rest will drive you crazy? Got quiet. Yeah, rest. His rest will drive you completely crazy. Because you know why? You're going to find out in his rest, he don't move nothing like you do. And in his rest, you're going to find out instead of what you've been trying to do, he's already done it for you. And that about drive you crazy right there. The first thing, what am I supposed to do? Learn how to rest first. Well, what do you mean rest? See, told you. We won't learn how to rest because it seems like we're so inactive. And yet at the same time, I'm more active in rest than I was when I was working because I'm active in the right way. See, in rest, I find myself not worried because I'm able to thank God because in his rest, I see what he rested from. See, he rested from some of the things I've been working on trying to get. You know, I was trying to get right. I got in his rest. You know what I found out? He had already made me right. So now when I say I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, I can only know that in rest. Because before rest, I'm trying to get right. I'm always trying to get right. I'm always trying to get right. Every time I go to church, I'm trying to get right. I'm trying to live right. I'm trying. That's the problem. You are trying and he's already done what you're trying to do. You can't improve on that. And so when I get into his rest, I realize one thing. All those years I spent trying. And it's nothing more deflating to a saint than to be trying so hard and then get smacked with another trial and they rolling again. Oh, God, please, Lord. I don't know why the devil attacking me like this. Because he know you ain't resting. Devil is all about work. Devil is all about trying to tell you how to get yourself together. The devil's always trying to point out your faults and flaws. The devil's always trying to show you, hey, you ain't got enough. You ain't got enough. You need to do more. If you want to be like God, let me tell you something. You couldn't go to Von Moore's and buy anything out there and make you look like God. No. We've been fooled. We've been really fooled. You want to know what God looked like? Look at Jesus. Just look at him. Don't just look at him, but study him. Don't just study him. Indulge in him. Don't just get saturated with it. I go back and read. I told him a long time ago in my early start of the ministry in which I became a part of, I began to realize one thing is that man has a way of doing something, but Jesus has a different way. Every time. And most of our ways in which we do things is not like God because he already told us, and yet we'll still try to perpetuate our ways on people and tell them that it's God. No, we need personally to know that God is giving us this stuff. We're killing ourselves for no reason. And the only thing God is asking is for, can you believe me? Can you believe me? You know, if he was going to cry over anything, he'd be crying because of our lack of faith. Why won't they believe me? See, Brother Rule, I'm telling you. Me and Brother Thorne was talking this morning. This is so simple, but it's so complex for us. Because the hardest thing to do is die to yourself and realize that God is bigger than you are. I already knew about you before you showed up. And that you are not surprising God by you being saved. And that somehow or another, it wasn't based upon you in the first place. It was based upon what he done for you that made you be saved. And you're so afraid that you're going to make a mistake that you're making the biggest mistake of all. And that's not believing him. That's your biggest mistake. That's why when he came to the Jews, he said, you know, when the Son of Man returns, shall he find faith on earth? Would he find faith? Because the one thing that was lacking, because everybody was so hooked up on what they were doing, is that it's hard to have faith in God when you believe in what you're doing is so good. I believe in what he done was better. And then, so I thank him every day for what he's done for me. Amen. I'm not looking. I told you before, I'm not looking for a blessing. I'm already blessed. You know what I'm saying? I know some of y'all that can't get that concept yet, but I'm telling you, quit getting up talking about I need a blessing. Go ahead and thank God that you are blessed. That's what you need to do. Learn how to thank God every day. I'm so blessed. And Lord, I appreciate your blessing in my life. I am not going out looking for one. I know that when I walk in that Thanksgiving like that, man, I'm opening up the windows of heaven. I'm opening up God to do stuff for me that I had never dreamed he would do. I'm getting ready to have a miracle soon. Now, I know. It's okay, though. Because, see, I already know. Where is it going to come from? I have no idea, but I just in my soul, God knows I'm going to need one, and I already told him I'm thanking him for it already. I'm going to check my mailbox every day. Well, what if it don't come? See, that's your thoughts. I don't look at a glass to see if it's half empty. See, I already know. If it ain't there Monday, I'm going to be just excited on Tuesday. I ain't even worried about it. You know why? Because when you started really walking in this thing, you started walking in faith and believing God and watching God do things, the next thing you know, anything come up, a crisis come up, you don't see it as a crisis, you see it as an opportunity. You begin to realize one thing, God has allowed this for another opportunity to show himself strong in my life again. He wants me to be able to testify, tell people how good he is. And that's what I want to be a witness. I want to have a testimony in my life that says God is so good. I don't want to walk right here talking about, you know, well, you know, God, he won't keep me so poor and humble and everything, you know, boss. I don't serve a God to make me look ugly like that. He has beautified me with salvation. And I'm going to be happy every day of my life because I'm not going to allow things around me to determine how saved I am or anything else like that. I'm not going to let them tell me some kind of old crazy report. My salvation includes my healing, my deliverance, my prosperity, my safety, my keeping, my salvation. It entails all of that. When I say I'm saved, I'm saved. I'm not talking about a part of myself. I'm looking at the whole enchilada, guacamole, and even the sour cream on top. I want it all. I'm not trying to shortcut God. I don't want to live beneath what God is trying to bring me up to. I'm not the kind to settle in out of court. In his gates, thanksgiving, into his courts. That's why I'm praising, because I refuse to settle outside of the court. I'm going to praise him. I came in with thanksgiving, and I came in with praise. Anything can happen today. Anything might happen today. Why? Because I expect God. Every day I get up, I expect something from God. I don't know what it's going to be, have no idea what it's going to look like, but every day I live, I expect God to be real in my life. I look for God to be real in my life. Praise God. Part of our, oh man. But we are going to start next time on this true spiritual progression. I'm not quite sure, just below the Tabernacle of David, we're going to start on that next one there for real. I'm not going to even allow myself to even talk about David's Tabernacle at all. That way I won't get sidetracked. So I'm just going to start. The next time we're going to start right here. I got to show you the progression of God, show you how that works for you. You need to understand he came down, not that you would stay down, but that you would go up. You understand? He didn't intend for you to get earthbound. Did you realize that? That's why the Bible says that second out, born from heaven, came from heaven. because he want to give you a seat in heaven. He want to let you sit in heavenly places. He wants you to be blessed in the heavenlies, not just in earthly. Thank God for the things he gives us here on earth. But there's greater things even in the spirit that will enrich your soul more than a new car. Shake hands with somebody. Be friendly. God bless you today. Amen.